it's that guy 2 weeks in a row. What is going on? How's everybody doing? I hope you're doing well. Yeah, if you're brand new, the reason everybody around you looks so disappointed is that we have a teaching team and we rotate, and so normally you're not in the same place 2 weeks in a row, but I was here last week. But here's the best thing about that is that you know next week you're going to get a much younger, hipper pastor, okay? So definitely come back next week. Let's start off this way. If I met you out in the field or we were sitting down having coffee together, and I said, hey, I got two deals for you. You just need to pick which deal you want. The first deal is this. I'm going to give you $10,000 a day for 31 days. Some of you are like, I don't even need to pray about that. Yes. Okay, let's do it. But I have another deal for you, and you got to pick. And the other deal is I'm going to give you a penny on the first day, and then we're going to double it, and I'll give you two pennies on the second day. And then we're just going to keep doubling it for the 31 days. Which deal do you want? Now, for most of us, because $10,000 sounds like so much money, and you think, oh, that's $310,000 at the end of 31 days. That's our first instinct is to go for that. But you probably figured out that the second deal is probably the one you need to go for. But did you know that if you double a penny for 31 days, it would actually be not $310,000. It'd be $10.7 million. Somebody say, ooh. Everybody say, ah. Like, that is the power of compounding interest, guys. And God created mathematics. God created compounding interest. And it is a powerful force. It has the ability to rob you of joy if you are on the downside and have compounding interest working against you because you have debt in your life. It can rob you of joy. It can rob you of peace in your life. It can mess up relationships. It can give you all kinds of stress, which then can affect your health. I mean, if compounding interest is working against you, you know, some of you, it is a powerful force. But it's also a powerful force for good. If you can get compounding interest working for you. And so that's what we want to talk about. Now, last week we started this series called Mind Your Own Business. And the reason we called it that is because most of the time if a guy gets up like me and starts talking to church people about money, the looks on their faces basically say, hey, preacher, mind your own business, okay? This is our deal. But what we learned last week is that really it's not even your business. It's God's business. God gave you money. God gave you a body to go earn money. Gave you a mind to go earn money. It's all his. And so what God has done for us is he has entrusted us with stuff. He's entrusted us with time, resources, energy, whatever. And he wants to see how we will steward his things. He's the owner. We steward it. And the hope is that one day we'll stand before him and he'll say, give us an account for how you used every dollar and give me an account for how you used every day. And we'll be able to show that to him and he's going to say, hey, well done, good and faithful servant. So we talked about some business principles in our personal finances last week. And this week we're going to dial into saving and investing. Now, for some of you, you're like me and you say, wait a second, the Bible says something about saving and investing? Well, yeah, it does. And I'm telling you what, the more I looked into it this week preparing for this message, the more I just took a step back and said, God, thank you so much for being a God that cares about the stuff that's going on in our everyday life. Thank you for giving us a book that is not just a roadmap for getting holy or getting religion or getting even close to Jesus and accepting him as our Lord and Savior, but also has stuff in there that applies practically to our everyday life. I loved it. And so we're going to talk a little bit about investing and saving. In Proverbs 6:6-8, it says this, go to the ant, you sluggard. Now that's a word we ought to bring back, you know what I mean? Sluggard. Consider its ways and be wise. The ant, it has no commander, no overseer, no ruler, and yet it stores provisions in the summer and it gathers food at the harvest. It's basically saying, hey, even the ant knows when it goes to a picnic and it sees a piece of chicken fall on the ground, I'm going to take that and I'm going to store it away, right? So because later on, I'm going to need that. That's savings. Now, I did a little research. Do you know how much the average person in Japan puts away? What percentage of their salary they save and invest every year? It's 18.2%. Isn't that great? Last week, we talked about, wouldn't it be great if we did 10%? 10% to God, 10% to savings, and then we lived on the rest, 80%. But in Japan, it's 18.2%. Do you know how much the average person in the United States puts away? Do you think it's 15%? Do you think it's 10%? How about 5%? The average person in America pays $1.22 for every dollar that they earn. Folks, I want you to think about that because that boat won't float for very long. That's compounding interest. That's debt. We're living on our credit cards. We're living on second mortgages, and it will not work long term. And I'm telling you, that is the power of compounding interest coming against us as, you know what, that's why Visa and MasterCard are so rich. That's why they've got all the money, because compounding interest is working for them. And by the way, the Bible says that the borrower is slave to the lender. Have you ever tried to call Visa up and say, hey, you know what? We had a down month in our business, didn't get a lot of sales in. We're not going to be able to pay you this month. Did they say, hey, you know what? No problem. Don't you even worry about it. No, they didn't. You ever call your mortgage company and say, hey, we had a little emergency medically? I mean, it's not even my fault. It's just like a medical emergency. We're not going to be able to pay the mortgage for a couple of months. What did they do? They looked at you with cold, hard, steely eyes and said, I don't care a bit about your medical issue. We want our money. They are horrible masters, okay? So we don't want to be slaves to them. We want to get on the other side of this powerful penny phenomenon called compounding interest. That penny illustration, I love it. So what are we going to save for? We're going to save for emergencies. We're going to save for emergencies because y'all know sometimes the roof leaks, sometimes the car breaks down, we have emergencies. So we're going to put away a 3-month or 4-month or whatever, maybe even a 6-month emergency fund, and we're going to let that emergency fund be there so that when the thing breaks, when the washer and dryer breaks, I don't have to whip out a credit card and get that much farther behind letting compounding interest work against me. Are you with me on that? So we're going to save for emergencies. We're also going to save for purchases. Now, I'm not talking about, you know, little things. I'm talking about like your washer and dryer. I'm talking about we're going to save for, new couch, new furniture. We're not going to go into Home Depot and say, wow, I can save 5% if I open up a Lowe's or a Home Depot credit card. You don't save 5%. You're still going to pay about 16, 17% of interest, okay? On that credit card. Or I'm not going to go into Art Van and take 6 months same as cash or whatever, because eventually I'm going to be paying on that credit card, okay? So we want to pay for our purchases up front with savings money rather than our debt money. And here's the thing. For some of us, we could still sing Christmas carols right now. You say, what are you talking about? Because we're still in the Christmas season. Because we're still paying for purchases at Christmas. You say, but I love Christmas, you know? I want to do Christmas big. That's great. But instead of paying for last Christmas every month, why don't you start paying every month to yourself, get compounding interest working for you now for next Christmas if you want to do Christmas big. That's great. Then, guys, when you got that wonderful gift pick out for your bride at Bass Pro Shop, then you will be able to do that and have compounding interest work for you. And the third thing we want to pay for is, we want to save for is the future. We want to save for the future because some of us, we want to retire one day. At some point, we want to send our kids to college. At some point, we want to, watch this. Here is a biblical principle that I found and I went, you know what? That's just kind of slipped out of our collective consciousness. Our culture has kind of just gotten away from this. Watch this. A good person leaves an inheritance for their children's children, but a sinner's wealth is stored up for the righteous. Do you see that? How many of you have as part of your goal, as part of what you think about, one of your desires in life is to have something to pass on to your kids, even your grandkids? See, that was something, if you go back 50 years, if you go back a couple of generations, people thought family, people thought legacy. And they said, you know what, I'm just going to consume everything I have. I'm not even going to store up just enough to get me by in my retirement. But I want to have, I want to bless my family, my kids' kids. Wouldn't it be great if instead of thinking about ourselves and consuming everything and only thinking about today, we took that biblical principle in Proverbs 13, 22. So we're going to save for the future. Proverbs 21:20 says, in the house of the wise there are stores of choice food and oil, food and olive oil, but fools gulp theirs down. What that's saying is that a wise person lives with a little bit of margin. They live a little below their means, but a fool's going to live paycheck to paycheck. That's basically what that says. And 75% of Americans are living paycheck to paycheck. All right, so we want to get away from that because there's two ways you can make money. One way is the traditional way. You go get a job. It says in 2 Thessalonians 3:10 that if a man will not work, he shall not eat. So we get a job, we get paid. That's the traditional way. But you will know the best way to make money is make your money make money. Put your money to work for you. Jesus said in Matthew 25:16, he was giving us this principle of the parable of the stewards. This idea that a landowner is going to give his resources to these stewards and then they're going to go out. And look what happened. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to what? To work. And he gave 5 bags more. And you know what's great about your money? It works 365 days a year for you. It never takes a vacation. It can always be working for you when you have compounding interest working for you, savings. We talked about this a little bit last week. You remember we talked about foo-foo coffee? Come on, who's with me on this? We talked about foo-foo coffee because right now I've got a little bit of quietness in the crowd because everybody feels like they're going to the dentist. Everybody feels like, oh, don't talk about this. I know I should do it, but I don't want to do it. I feel a little intimidated by, you know, savings and investing and all that kind of stuff. I just want to talk about something else. But here's the thing. Here's the thing. You can do it. Last week we talked about, you know what, if you would just skip your big coffee that you get, that foo-foo coffee, you know what I'm talking about? Last week we said mocha frappa cappuccino with a shot of estrogen, and I love saying that, but someone shared with me a new coffee drink I'd never heard of. It's a frozen caramel emasculato, all right? So I love that, but here's the deal. Some of us are going and we're paying $5 a day for these things, or we're going through drive-thrus, or we're going to the movies, and we're paying $10 million for popcorn every year. Listen, you can save $5 a day. And here's what's fun about that. We looked at that last week. We said if you put that in an investment, $5 a day, over 10 years at 10% interest in an investment, that's going to be like $30,000. We said over 30 years, if you did that, it'd be around $300,000. But this week, I had the idea, what if we just let it ride? What if there's, I mean, there's 20-year-olds, there's 20-year-olds in here, people that are just starting out their work, and the rest of us, we remember those days. Here's the thing. What if we'd have started when we were 20, 21, 22 years old, and we did this for 45 years, did it on until we were 65 years old, just foo-foo coffee. I'm not talking about your 401k, your company's pension plan, your retirement. I'm not talking about any of that. Just your foo-foo coffee at 10% over 45 years, guess what? The power of compounding interest kicks in, and it's $1.3 million. Come on. What could you do for God with $1.3 million in the bank? How easy could you sleep at night with $1.3 million in the bank? What lives could you change in your family if you had $1.3 million in the bank? So I want to give you, I'm telling you what, wherever you are, because some of you are going, well, I missed the boat, I'm not 20. So here's the deal. Wherever you are, you can improve your situation. And can I tell you something else? Talk about your children and your children's children. What if we passed on, maybe we don't have the legacy of inheritance to pass on to them, but we could pass on some wisdom. Come on, somebody. What if we said, you know what? I missed the boat. I'm 65 and I'm not in the place where I'm going to be able to do that. But you better believe I'm going to call up my son or I'm going to call up my granddaughter and we're going to have a little family meeting. I'm going to teach them some biblical principles about the power of compounding interest, and generations of my family are going to be changed because of the wisdom of God in their life. So everybody needs to listen to what I'm about to tell you. 7 principles for biblical investing. Somebody just went, wait, that whole thing was just the introduction? We're going to be here forever, okay? We got 7 principles, and if you'll just hang with me, I promise when Brad preaches next week, it'll be pointless, okay? I've got 7 points, but he'll be pointless, all right? I didn't set that joke up well. Anyway, sounded like I was just being mean to Brad. Anyway, let's move on. Here's the first principle. We're not going to try to get rich quick. 1 Timothy 6:9 says, people who want to get rich fall into temptation. Where's the scripture? Those who want to get rich quick fall into temptation and a trap and into many foolish and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. So when money was tight, trying to get into this building way back when, and we're trying to figure out everything. I mean, I was thinking, we'll cast vision, I'll send letters, we'll do bake sales. I mean, how are we going to do this? And I'm praying through this, and someone calls me up and says, hey, did you hear the lottery just hit $242 million? Now, the name of our church is 242, so I said, is that a sign from the Lord? Does he want me to go out? So here's what I did. I took $2, right? Cash, isn't that, that's what it costs. Take $2. I said, I'm going to double my money. I take $2 out, and I just folded it over and put it back in my wallet. I doubled my money right there, okay? Because here's the thing. Lottery winners are usually lottery losers. Now, I don't mean the people are losers. They're loved by God. But I'm just saying, if you go and you look at the stories of lottery winners, of people that come into money really quickly, a lot of times they can't handle it and they end up losing it. That's what happens when people love money, they want to get, it's all about money. By the way, this whole day, this isn't about money today. Okay, this is about God's wisdom. It's not about being selfish and trying to get money for yourself and trying to get rich for yourself. Because when people have that as the motivation, you saw it in the scripture, they fall into all kinds of traps. All kinds of things go wrong. All right, so we don't want to get rich quick. The second principle is this. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. Some financial person in the room just said, wait a second. The principle of diversification is in scripture. Yes, it is. Look at this in Ecclesiastes 11:2. It says, invest in 7 ventures. Yes, in 8. Because you don't know what disaster may come upon the land. In other words, if I invest in real estate over here and a little cash over here, and I'm going to invest in stocks over here and the stock market goes bad, well, I still got real estate. Or if I'm going to invest in this thing over here, well, this thing is still okay. Does that make sense? So we diversify. Can anybody say Enron? You know the story? I mean, you watch that documentary, there are people that were literally weeks from retirement and they had put all their eggs in the Enron basket, and like weeks before their retirement, they were sitting pretty and they lost it all because they didn't follow the biblical principle of diversification. That's what we need to do. So very quickly, I'm gonna say something that for some of you is commonplace, you know it, for others it's intimidating. But it doesn't need to be intimidating because you can do it and you can understand it. It's called a mutual fund. It's a principle of diversification, real easy. We invest in a lot of different things, but let me just tell you, as an example, a mutual fund is basically when you take your foo-foo coffee money and you take your foo-foo coffee money and you take yours and I take mine, and we all put it together in one pot, and then we basically, we're going out and we're hiring some professional nerd to go out, and he's going to track all this stuff, and he's going to invest some of it all day long. He studies the market, and he's going to put some in stocks, and he's going to put some in bonds, and he's going to put some in cash, and he's going to put some overseas, and he's going to diversify our money. And then when the stock market, when the economy changes, he's going to move and manage that money for us. That's diversification. And how cool is it to think about somebody else that's like out there managing your money? It's pretty cool. So we want to take advantage of that where we can. And if you don't know how to do that, then go to Financial Peace University. I talked to you about it last week. I don't get kickbacks from that program. We don't charge. You know, it all just is like, you know, pays for itself. Just go take that thing and you will learn this stuff. And it doesn't have to be intimidating. You can do it. All right. So we don't want to put all our eggs in one basket. Here's principle number 3. We're not going to invest in things that we don't understand. Are you with me on this? Proverbs 24 says, By wisdom a house is built and through what? Understanding it is established. Wisdom, understanding. Through what? Knowledge, its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful treasures. I don't want to invest in something I don't understand. For example, in 1999, the most widely held stock in the United States was GE, General Electric. I can go to Home Depot and Lowe's and I can see what General Electric does. I see what they make, right? And I can understand that. Back in 1999, the second most widely held stock was Lucent Technologies. Maybe people in here had Lucent Technology. I feel bad for you if you did, because in 1999, if you put $1,000 in Lucent Technology, by 2007, that was worth $57. You've gone from $1,000 to $57. fact, if you'd invested in Diet Coke, you'd have had $79. And I don't mean invest in the company. I mean just went out and bought a bunch of Diet Coke at the grocery store. Because those 10 cans would have been worth more than Lucent stock in 2007. And it really, think about it, like, it's because I didn't even understand what Lucent was. Don't invest in things you don't understand. Here's number four. Number four is count the cost when you're investing. Luke 14:28. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not sit down first and count the cost, whether he has enough to finish it? Lest he have the foundation and is not able to finish it, all who see it begin to mock him, saying, this man began to build and was not able to finish. He didn't count the cost. Now, here's how we need to change our mindset. We need to change our mindset from monthly bill payers to marathon investors. Monthly bill payers to marathon investors. So the way you count the cost is not how much does it cost every month. Quit thinking like that. It's hard because all the car companies we're working for, they don't even tell us the cost of the car anymore. You go watch the thing, they're just going to tell you what it costs what. They just tell you the monthly payment. And we start thinking, well, how much can we afford every month? We got to quit thinking that way. It's not the monthly cost. It's not even the total cost. Now, that's better if we can stop thinking of, you know, getting into debt on everything and have the power of compounding interest working against us and start getting into cash. That's better. But what's even better than that is not the total cost or the real cost, but is the, watch this, the missed opportunity cost. Hang with me. This can change your life. This can help with contentment. Because what we want to do is not think monthly cost or even real cost, but the missed opportunity cost. I went and bought a mower. And let me tell you, man, when they show you a mower, they got all these different options, all these different engine sizes and everything. And they show me this mower over here, and that's just like to tease you, right? They're just like, I'm going to give you this mower, but look at this mower. It's got bigger wheels. It's got a bigger engine. I felt myself starting to grunt a little bit. And then they showed me this mower over here, and it was like, and I had hair just like popping out of my chest. It was just, I mean, I was feeling so good. And the difference between the mower that I bought and the mower that I really wanted to get was $1,000. And do you know what made the difference in my mind? It wasn't, now think, monthly payment. That's what they were trying to sell me on. Hey, the difference between those two mowers, it's like 10, 15 bucks a month. But that's not the way I'm thinking about the cost of something. So, well, the difference of that mower, if you pay cash, is just $1,000. But I'm not thinking like that, the real cost of something. I'm thinking, if I take that $1,000 and put it in my foo-foo coffee fund, and it's there for 20 years at 10%, that's $6,700. So that mower didn't cost me $15 a month. It didn't even cost me $1,000. It cost me $6,700. And I tell you what, when you start thinking like that, when you start thinking marathon investing, the goals you have for the future, it's a whole lot easier to say no to stuff because everything costs way much more. Does that make sense to you? All right, let's keep going. I'm just trying to help you out, all right? Number five, walk with the wise. Now, we talked about this last week. This is just get people around you that can give you good advice. And so we talked about it last week. I'm going to move on. Number six says this, get organized. Get organized, because when you're organized, you're going to have less stress when it comes to your finances. And I want you to be able to sleep at night. I want you to be able to look at it. I want you to be able to go on date nights with your spouse and not fight over money. So here's how this works. When we're not organized, it's like when you go to the doctor and they say, you know, I've got a pain here or a problem here. And they say, we're going to give you a couple tests. And we're not going to give you the results of the test for 4 or 5 weeks. And you go, what? And what's life like for those 4 to 5 weeks? You're just sitting there going, because you're stressed out about the possible future and the negative thing that could happen in the future. And you don't know if it's going to happen, but just not even knowing is just so stressful. And that's what is happening with a lot of us, not when we're 30, not when we're 40, when we start hitting 55 and 60 and 61 and 62, and we're starting to go, I can barely sleep at night because I don't know how the pension works and the Medicaid works, and I'm not quite sure how Social Security is going to kick in, and I don't have anybody telling me about mutual funds or how that's going to work because we're not organized, and it's causing us stress. And then because it causes us stress, we just don't want to think about it and we just kind of push it off. And I'm telling you, if you'll get organized, and we can help you do this, if you get organized, you'll put it at peace. Proverbs 27:23 says this, "Be diligent to know the state of your flocks and attend to your herds." How were your wealth? How was wealth measured back then? How big was your flock? How big was your herd? And be diligent to know the state of that. And I'm just saying, we're here to help you. If you want to go to financial peace, we can help you get organized with those things. And then finally, this is the one that I think, I just love this. Look at this. Invest justly. This gets back to the fact that you didn't hear a message today about getting rich. You didn't hear a message today about, you know, just where it's all about money. Listen to this. We want to invest God's money in a way that's honoring to him. It says in Psalm 112:5, it says, "It's well with the man who deals generously and lends, who conducts his affairs with justice." Proverbs 16:8, "Better is a little with righteousness than vast revenues without justice." And Proverbs 22:16 is probably my favorite one. "He who oppresses the poor to make more for himself or gives to the rich will only come to poverty." In other words, I'm not going to invest in some company that's doing slave labor with kids. God's not going to honor that. I'm not going to invest. Hey, somebody comes up to me and goes, "Hey, I got a great real estate opportunity. I mean, it's just growing and growing and growing. What is it? Strip clubs?" I'm not going to get involved in that. I don't care how much money I can make. Do you understand? This is about honoring God with every part of our lives. And if we'll honor God, he honors us, which is a beautiful, beautiful thing. I'll give you a couple to think about. One would be Kiva. Kiva's micro business loans to third world countries. And so I'm going to help, I'm going to invest a little money helping someone maybe start a business in their village to help them in their life. Love that ministry. I love the Solomon Foundation that helps build churches. I want to get involved in stuff that's going to honor God. All right. Well, we got to wrap this up. So I got to tell you, I was on a trip this week and they flew me in and put me up in this hotel. And the hotel was fine, but it's just like any hotel when you've, the towels in the hotel. If you've seen the hotel towels, I mean, you know what I'm talking about. They're thin. They've been washed a million times. And all I wanted to do was take a shower and go to bed after that long trip. And I'm looking at this towel and I was going, eh. And I remembered when I was walking in that there was a Walmart right next door. And I'm embarrassed to tell you this, but I thought, you know what? I'm worth 12 bucks. Okay, I'm going to go, and I walked over to Walmart, and I grabbed one of these big, white, fluffy towels, and seriously, it was like $12.50 or something, and I put that in my cart, and so I'm heading back, getting excited about, you know, we'll take a nice shower, a hot shower, and then I saw this sign, it said 75% off bed sheets, and have you seen those reports with the purple lights in the hotel rooms? And I'm thinking bed bugs and all kinds of stuff. I'm just like, it's 75% off. And I appreciate a good thread count. And so I took those sheets and I put them in my cart and I kept going. And then I saw a Dyson fan. Has anybody seen a Dyson fan? I'm kind of a geek, tech geek, you know. And I saw this fan that it's like bladeless. And I, like through voodoo technology, it somehow moves the, I don't know, but I was like, that's so cool. And I was in a warm climate. And I thought, what if the air conditioning doesn't keep up in my hotel? So I took that Dyson fan, I put it right in my cart. And I kept going. And I realized, you know what? The TV in the hotel room, only 36 inches. And people shouldn't have to live like that. So I went over and I got a 55-incher and I put that in my cart. And then I checked out. And as I'm walking across, I thought, you know what? I called a contractor. I said, can you be out here tonight? Because what I want to do is I want to bump out a bay window in my hotel room and get a hot tub put right in there. It'd be great. Now, at some point, you just went, hold on a second. You didn't do all that. And you're right. I didn't do any of it. But my point is this, if you said, hold on, that doesn't seem right, it's probably because you thought something like this in your mind. Why would anybody spend so much money and so much time and effort trying to make themselves more comfortable in a place they're only going to stay a couple nights? And if you thought something like that, can I ask you a question? Why do we spend so much time and so much money and so much effort trying to make ourselves a little bit more comfortable on this earth where, relative to eternity, we're only going to be here a couple nights? Amen? See, I want you to be wildly successful. But it's not so that you can be a little more comfortable, so that you can get a, you know, bump out your bay windows or you know, be a little more impressive to the people around you. That's not what this day is about. I'll tell you what it's about. It's the motivation that Paul had for Timothy in 1 Timothy 6:17. He said, "Command those who are rich in this present world not to be arrogant nor put their hope in wealth." I'm not going to get my self-esteem from my wealth. I'm not going to get my security for the future in my wealth. Wealth which is so uncertain, but to put their hope in God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. Command them to do good, to be rich in good deeds, and to be generous and willing to share. In this way, they will lay up treasure for themselves as a firm foundation for the coming age, so that they may take hold of the life that is truly life. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. God, I thank you for your word, which speaks so practically to our lives. Father, I pray for those in this room that are overwhelmed by finances, whether it's just a low-grade stress that's always with them as they get older, or whether it is a person that is in financial crisis in this moment, or whether it is a marriage that is on the rocks and they would point to money as one of the key issues. Father, I pray that you would just put a little bit of hope on our hearts right now. I pray, God, that you'd put a little wisdom in our minds, that you would let us know what is the next step we can take to move forward in this very powerful area of our lives. God, we want to give you we don't just want to trust you with our eternity. We want to trust you with our here and now. We want to trust you with every area of our lives. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.